Welcome, everyone. Thank you all so much for joining us today. It's our great pleasure to have Whitney Hayes with Kentucky Protection and Advocacy with us. I'll just kind of go over a few things here in the beginning, and I'll just be helping out, changing the slides for Whitney and helping with questions and sort of facilitating that and everything. My name is Rhonda, and I'm with Kentucky SPIN, and it's Kentucky Special Parent Involvement Network. And we all are parents, person and or persons with disabilities or family members helping one another. We do have the Parent Training and Information Project for the state of Kentucky and have had that since 1988, since Kentucky first received that. It's really important to know what we do as much as what we don't do. We do not act as attorneys. We do help to effectively advocate for your child or for self-advocates for themselves and really provide that peer support role to help you to be able to advocate effectively, but also to know your rights as well as, different things with education. But we also help families because as a family myself, you know that there are many different systems when you do have a disability or someone in your family with it. And so we do help to work through different things. We help people to understand Medicaid waivers and a whole variety of things. And if we can't help or are not the appropriate person, we will help connect you with who is. So we're going to go ahead and, sorry, I clicked too fast there. Whitney Hayes, I don't know how many years that we've worked together, but she is the best ever. And she is there to help everybody. And she has a great knowledge. And we are just so grateful that she joined us today to talk about the 504 plans. What are they and how they can help? So Whitney, what I'll do, first of all, you will see that you have two handouts. And we're going to also follow up with the PowerPoint and send that to you in PDF version. But if you don't have time to download the handouts that you see there, we always follow up with the email following the webinars, which will include those too. So you don't have to worry about that. Also, too, you can ask questions, and I'll help facilitate those as we kind of step through it. And Whitney, what we can do is if you'd like to pause every so often, it's really up to you. I don't know if you want to wait all the way to the end, but sometimes typically we will kind of pause throughout to check in to see if there's any questions, but you just let me know. And we're just so grateful that you joined us. I hope everyone's doing well and staying safe. So take it away, Whitney.
Thank you, Rhonda, for having me here today. I'm just going to do a sound check. Can you hear me?
Yes, you're okay. Perfect.
Good. If you can't hear me, let me know. If you see a question as I go through these slides, Rhonda, just stop and let me know, and we'll
okay. And I'll keep an eye on those.
Yeah, and then at the end, I have a slide that says at the end for any further questions, too.
Okay, awesome. Thank you so much.
No problem. And as Rhonda said, the publications that are going to be attached to this PowerPoint, they're going to be sent out via email, but they're also available on Protection and Advocacy's website. And I can get you that email address, too, just in case. As Rhonda said, I am with, my name is Whitney Hayes. I'm a staff attorney at Kentucky Protection and Advocacy. I work on the children and youth team. You want to next slide? Rhonda, can you go?
So there's a little delay I'll have to tell you in when it will show up for you. So
okay.
Bear with me just a moment because sometimes not the most efficient, but I'm going to try to be good here.
That's good. You're fine. You're doing great.
Okay.
Good. And what you may not have heard about protection and advocacy, every state has a protection and advocacy system. Kentucky's protection and advocacy system is called Kentucky Protection and Advocacy. It's within the Department of Public Advocacy, Public Defenders, but we just got placed there by the governor. We are federally funded. We provide legally based individual and systemic advocacy and education. And similar to Kentucky SPIN, If we can't provide you the answers, we can always try to refer you to the correct people who could perhaps answer your questions. We are made up of attorneys and advocates who have either lived experience or had experience with disabilities. So we can either do an information referral service, like I said, technical assistance, which is providing assistance over the phone. Oh, and like we can open up cases where we can attend meetings if needed. We are funded by 7 different grants, as you can see. So we cover all disabilities from birth to death. So usually what I tell people is, if you have a question and you think that your rights have been violated because of a person's disability, go ahead and give us a call. And we can at least say, no, that's not a violation. That's not a legal violation. We can't help you. My understanding from talking to a lot of individuals with disabilities is they don't know who to call, and they're just always wondering. And so we can always provide you with that information. So I'm here today to talk about what is 504 plan. And I know that we wanted to go into how it can help it. So I separated it down to the two questions. And I've also, to get to the first question about what is a 504 plan, I think we need to look at what the law says. So 504 plans protect schools from discriminating against students with disabilities. They help make sure that they cannot violate a student's civil rights, is what the schools do. It's based upon Section 504 of the Rehabilitation Act of 1973. It was one of two primary laws to assist students with disabilities. The first one you may have already heard about, which is the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act. And that's a little bit different than 504, and I'll go into that in a second about a kind of a comparison about the two. So, the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act is primarily an education law. It covers children from age 3 to 21 when they enter school. IDEA, there's different parts of IDEA, but once kids enter preschool and then follows them up until they graduate high school or they turn 21. And in it, with IDEA, you are provided specially designed instruction, which means that they make arrangements so that you can understand the content level, the grade level topics that they're teaching for a child. Section 504 is a little bit different. It's a civil rights law. It covers all ages. And so it can last, you can have one starting in elementary school, and it lasts through college. And it provides accommodations, meaning, unlike 504, where they may have to change the way that they're teaching a child or a student the education or the material. Students, teachers do not change the way, but they provide accommodations on how, so that the student can better learn. And I'll get into the what kind of accommodations we're talking about later in this presentation. And I always think it's important that parents and students with disabilities have the links to the law so that they can look it up. And so you have the Federal Civil Rights Law, which makes Section 504, puts it into law. Then you have the federal regulations, which makes up the rules of how they're going to fulfill the civil rights law. And that's the link to the regulations. The Americans with Disabilities Act of 1990 expanded the protections within Section 504. And so this is what primarily Section 504 says in a nutshell, that a handicapped person shall not be discriminated or excluded from participation in or have or subject to discrimination under any program or activity which received federal financial assistance. We're going to break that down now, but I also wanted you to see the specific section that's usually talked about it. Again, there's a link. So effective programs. So any program that's read by a federal agency, federal employment, any programs that receives federal funding, like private schools, public schools, can get are subject to 504, the 504 law. They have to provide those protections. So I understand that some students that may go into private school, you think it doesn't apply. IDEA doesn't apply. Wouldn't apply in certain situations if they didn't receive but 504 might, because it received federal funding. That's the first question you need to ask. Do you get any money from the federal government? Students are protected. If the student has a physical or mental disability that substantially limits one or more of his major life activities, is regarded as having a disability, or has a record of having a disability. So they, again, this is a lot of information. I'm going to break these three pieces down. Next. The substantial limitation. So the student has to have a physical or mental disability, and that substantially limits them. The 504 law regulation did not define what substantial limitation was. However, the regulation for the ADA, which was passed in 1990, said an impairment is a disability if it substantially limits the ability of an individual to perform a major life activity, as compared to the most people in the general population. So you're taking a person with a disability and you're comparing them with a person that doesn't have a disability. So what is the major life activity? Well, the federal regulation gave examples, such as caring for oneself, performing manual tasks, walking, seeing, hearing, speaking, breathing, learning, walking. It's pretty much encompassing. Next, and I think the next slide has some other major ones. Thinking, concentrating. They say emotional learning disability, reading, if you have problems interacting with others. So that it gives a full range of major life activities. So what does the school must provide? It has to provide a child like IDEA. 504 has to provide a child with a free and appropriate public education. So the education with accommodations that is comparable to the education of a person that does not have a disability. And it has to provide equal opportunities to participate in the school's extracurricular activities. Extracurricular activities include choir, sports, clubs, activities like that. So what kind of accommodations can you get? Remember earlier I said specially designed instruction is when they relate, when teachers change the way that they're teaching the students the information. Accommodations, extra time on assignments or tests. You can get modified assignments. Now, you know, maybe that means shortened assignments, breaks during the day, preferential seating, visual aids, reader or scribe, extra time to transition from class to class. I've seen sometimes you may have a child with an IEP, and sometimes these accommodations may be put in there. But if you have a child that, you know, doesn't have that, they say that the school says doesn't qualify, you might be, but these are some of the examples that he may need in his to help it make through the day. The school may give him 504. So Rhonda, I think this may be a good time. Have you gotten any questions?
Just one. Is in the list of accommodations, is there just a certain list of things you can only get? Is that the only thing you can get, like what was listed, or?
No, the first slide I presented were the examples that are listed in the regulation. And then in our experience, there's the second slide. I don't know if you can go back. has other examples, I think, that we've seen, that I've seen in our agents, other advocates and attorneys have seen in our agency that students receive. You're good. Okay, you're doing good. But I want to go up. Effective programs, next, eligibility crime, substantial. So the first list, and then the second one, I think, yeah, go back. I think most of them, yeah, the breaks during the day, I do not believe it was listed in regulation. And the reader scribe, I don't think is listed in the regulation. And I don't think extra time to transition from class to class is listed. But those are accommodations that usually the evaluation says, this is something a student may need, they can provide it. I've had a call where a child broke they had a broken body, so either her leg or arm, and she needed extra time. It was very short while the break healed because they were trying to protect the body part, I can't remember. And so I said, well, ask them for a 504 to get the time to transition from class to class.
Okay, wonderful. Thank you. There's not any other questions right now, but thank you so much.
And like I said, if you see any more and if something comes up, let me know too as we go.
I will. And let me just preface this with letting everyone know that this is my first time watching the, which should be scary to you all, the questions and everything. So if I do miss it, I apologize. But we can also follow up after this. We will have emails if I happen to miss it. So I apologize in advance. No.
Don't. If you miss it, then just email me the questions and I can follow up with the, if the person leaves their email address, I can follow up with them usually. So if you pull it out. So awesome. The next, how can a 504 help? When to ask for a 504. So a student who does not qualify for an IEP, and I have on here at any time. For example, a student may qualify. I've had cases where a student has qualified for an IEP for a specific period of time. They've done a reevaluation, and they decide he doesn't qualify anymore. I've gone through all the records, and the accommodations you could get on a 504. I usually tell the parent, suggest to parents, go ahead and request a 504. And there may be a time when a parent may request an initial evaluation, and the initial evaluation comes for an IEP, and the IEP comes back, or the evaluation comes back for the IEP, and the ARC meets, and it comes back, and they say, no, he doesn't qualify. You could ask for an independent evaluation, and the school comes back and says, no, he still doesn't qualify. That's when you ask for a 504. At any period of time, I would go forward and ask for a 504. The other time is if he attends a post-secondary school, a vocational school. Usually, the referral process differs between secondary and post-secondary schools. Today, I focused on secondary schools, but just to give you a little bit of information regarding post-secondary and vocational schools. When a child gets into post-secondary and vocational, and even if they had an IEP, that IEP ends when the student graduates high school. And schools will tell you, high school districts will tell you that, but they will not tell you that you can get a 504 in vocational or secondary. So what a child or student wants to do will take his most recent IEP or 504 and the evaluation copies to the school. The type of evaluation that the school requires varies. Schools are not required to identify students with disabilities. And so they will not, and they're not required to pay for an evaluation. So that's just information you might want to do. So let's focus on high schools and middle schools and elementary schools. So when you make a referral process, when you want to do a 504 referral, you can make a referral to the 504 coordinator. The school can make the referral or the parent. In my practice, it's usually the parent that makes the referral. It does not have to be in writing, but I highly suggest that it be in writing and you get a copy and you keep it for yourself. And I put in the referral a date when you would like to hear back from them. The 504 coordinator may be the district's director of special ed, but it doesn't have to be. So you may want to call the board office and say, who is the 504 coordinator? Also, in an IEP meeting, I've had meetings where the child does not qualify for an IEP. We say we want a 504 meeting, and the school may say, okay, well, you know, you have to call, that's another type of meeting. That's fine. Just be prepared. I'm telling you this because I want you to be prepared when they say that to you. So you may want, if you have a feeling going into an IEP evaluation or reevaluation that they may not find him qualified, you may want to get ahead of the process and ask, call before and say, who's your 504 coordinator? Make up the written response. So if they say, well, he doesn't qualify for an IEP, say, okay, well, I want a 504 evaluation, and hand them the written request. So evaluations, these are only 504. A district decides on whether to evaluate. They choose the evaluation process. They do not have to evaluate when a parent requests the district to do so. There's a lot of, it's much more more free toward the school. There are options if the school does not choose to evaluate, but, and I'm going to talk to you about that at the end. So hold on, if you've got, and then if you can't, if there's questions, we can go back. That's okay with Rhonda.
Absolutely.
Okay. Reevaluations. They can occur periodically, but I don't think the regulation does not say specifically how often. And the idea, it says every 3 years, unless the ARC decides that it's not needed. So you may want to call it, once you get a 504, you may want to call and say, I need a 504 meeting. So who's on the 504 team? Again, the law does not state who is on the 504 team. All it requires is that that individuals who are knowledgeable about the child and about the evaluation data and placement options are on the team. PNA recommends that the parent and the student be involved as much as possible. So I would always suggest that, again, if you wonder who's on the 504 team, make a written request to the 504 coordinator and say, can you tell me who will be at this meeting? And please let me know by a date. Because in my practice, I've seen a lot of times when districts will not get back to the school. And I try to give districts the benefit of the doubt sometimes because they've got a lot to go on. Because just reminding myself that at the end of the day, parents have to work with the districts for 18 years, for at least, till the child graduates, and sometimes you get more honey when you're more information when you're nice. So then, but the 504 team's job is to interpret evaluation data, determine accommodations, and make placement decisions. Usually, children with 504s are placed in the general education setting. Think about it, they're in the education setting, and so if they need a break and it's in their 504, they can walk up and take that break. And if something happens and a teacher says, no, you don't get the 504 break, I usually recommend, okay, then you have a 504 meeting. What about behaviors and disciplinary proceedings? A behavior plan can be part of the student's 504 plan. However, a school can discipline a student who has a 504. and charges can also be filed. That's important to know because I want to make sure all the parents know and all the students know what's going on. But if something is on the behavior plan in the 504 and the school and the child has a behavior and they want to suspend, the school says, okay, I want to suspend them for more than 10 days, they have to have a manifestation determination meeting. It only applies to out-of-school suspensions that are more than 10 days. I have had a lot of parents call me and say, my child has been suspended so many, 15 days. And I have to get into further detail. It's in-school suspensions that they're talking about. So I want you to focus on the out-of-school suspensions. Schools may not call this a manifestation determination meeting. They just may call it a 504 meeting. So first of all, you need to find out if it's a behavior and if it's out-of-school suspension. And then this is what the two questions are going to ask in the 504 meeting. Did this student's disability directly cause the behavior? Was it a manifestation? Was the student's behavior the result of the school's failure to implement the student's 504 plan? Those are the two questions that are asked. If the question to either of these answers is yes, then it's a manifestation and school cannot change placement. And if it's no, the behavior is now a manifestation and the school can change placement. When we're talking about placement in this circumstance, there may be situations where the school wants to place a child at an alternative school. And so that's where we're talking about regarding placement. So if they want a placement at alternative school, they can if the child's behavior was not a manifestation. So if the student's behavior was a manifestation, I would always suggest that the school conduct a functional behavior assessment and create a behavior plan. The functional behavior assessment is an evaluation really of the student's behavior. It's similar to what happens with students with an IEP in the fact that the school is looking, school psychologist is watching the student over several times to see what's the triggering at what the trigger of the behavior is. And then they should come up with a plan to address that behavior so that the behavior doesn't occur. I always say if schools file charges, no matter what situation he is in, you need to file, you need to have the functional behavior assessment done and get a behavior plan in place in a 504 plan or an IEP. There are three circumstances where a school can discipline a child in spite of the student's behavior, no matter what there is a manifestation of. If the student had weapons, if he has drugs, or if he caused serious bodily injury to another. And a serious bodily injury may be if the student gets disoriented and he has a habit of swinging and he may hit somebody accidentally. I've seen that be a serious bodily injury. It's circumstances you never see coming. You don't think about it and you step back and go, okay. But hey, Rhonda, do we have any questions yet?
I don't see any. Again, I'm hoping that I'm catching things, but please know that you can follow up with us afterwards if okay. I am not catching them.
Okay. So if you have a disagreement, you can request the local grievance policy from the 504 coordinator. I would always say, go ahead and request that at the beginning of the process. In the 504, like when you're asking for the evaluation, when you're asking for him to be evaluated, go ahead and request it at that time and have a copy with you. Every time, if you lose that copy, go into a 504 meeting and say, can I just have a copy of the local grievance policy? Just so in case there's a problem. You can also file a complaint with the U.S. Department of Education's Office of Civil Rights Division. It's called an OCR complaint. Those complaints have to be filed within 180 days of the actual violation. That's the link to the website. Anyone can file a complaint. And then OCR usually does not offer mediation, but it can facilitate a mediation to resolve a complaint. If I don't know how many individuals on the call webinar have had or know much about IEPs, but under the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, you can file a state complaint, you can mediate, or you can file litigation, which is called due process. So the mediation and the due process in this situation are not addressed. It's just solely the state OCR complaint, and then it can, that can lead to mediation. I think that's and then if you go, we've got our two publications, and those are what we are sending to you. They address the kids that are in elementary school, middle school, and high school, and then the students that are going into the post-secondary and vocational schools. Do we have any more questions?
Yes, we did have one that I see here that popped up. Is what would the time frame be from requesting the 504 to actually getting that in place?
I don't think there's a specific 504 specific time frame. I have seen cases where if you bring in an evaluation from a doctor, school has to evaluate. But if you bring in like doctor's evaluation or doctor's letter saying my child, I'm just making this up in my mind, has ADHD, or this from the doctor saying, yeah, the child has ADHD, these are the accommodations he needs, the school may put those accommodations, draft a temporary 504 plan while they evaluate. So it could almost be immediately that you have somewhat of a temporary 504 plan in place.
So there is one more. Does any of this take into account a parent's, input in the evaluation process and or the youth or child?
I think the law doesn't require that the parent or the student have input. In my experience, the schools try to have the parent and the youth provide input as much as possible. It's my understanding that the regulations require that they that the school use a plenary of resources. So they may ask the parent and youth different questions. If they've got further questions, I can clarify.
Yes, that does. And I do see one here. Hold on just a moment. You mentioned earlier that it lasted until your college ends. I was told that you could use it for life if the paperwork is correct and updated. Did something change?
Well,
can college students qualify for a 504 plan if they didn't have one previously? That's another question too.
Let me start with the second one first about qualifying in college, and then we'll go. 504, yes, a student can qualify for 504 in college if they didn't have one previously. And usually that's where you go into the evaluations process. If he didn't have a 504 previously, the school may require him to get a 504 to get an evaluation, but the college is not required to pay for that evaluation. The Office of Vocational Rehabilitation works with a lot of students with disabilities. But so you may want to check with your counties Office of Vocational Rehabilitation to see if they can provide some assistance, because it's my understanding that they have provided assistance to students with disabilities in college. Then the second one, then the one before that was about it lasted life through life, correct?
Yeah, it said, I'll read it one more time. You mentioned earlier that it lasted until your college ends. I was told that you could use it for life if the paperwork is correct and updated. Did something change?
If the paperwork is correct, or what happens is it's a list of accommodations and it can provide you with a reasonable accommodations under the Americans with Disabilities Act too. And so if depending, the Americans with Disabilities Act expanded on Office of Section 504 to make it to ensure that private businesses are providing accommodations to student, to individuals. Those accommodations that I list in the 504 may be accommodations you need in your job. So it can bleed into your job and help provide some documentation. I've got a disability, these are the accommodations I need. And then depending on where the job is, they can say, okay, we can develop an accommodation plan for you. Does that answer that question?
So it kind of switches, over to ADA once you exit grade school and college, so you're covered
right
under that.
Yeah, and 504, yes, ADA expanded on 504. So the 504 law. Because remember, 504 applies to anything that was getting federal funding, like federal agencies, federal employment. So that's why I'm saying, depending on the job.
Yeah, so, but if it is private, not federally funded, then you're covered there, which I think is what really helps a lot of us, is that there is that coverage. Thank you for explaining that.
Yes, and there are some limits on that too. So it has to be a reasonable accommodation too.
If I could just add here, who had asked the same question said ADA at 18, I understand.
Say that again, Rhonda. I misunderstood you.
If I'm understanding the question right, you're saying ADA would start at 18, but that's not true. It would cover you. It doesn't just start at 18.
Yeah, it doesn't start at 18. ADA covers all ages too. So if you have a child in child care, and in a child care facility, the ADA covers you. Primarily,
it depends on where they get, if they have federal funding or not, what's going to apply. So,
yes.
Thank you. Are there any, I don't see any more right here. I'm hoping I'm catching everything when it pops up here. Are there any tips that maybe you would like to leave us with that you think might be helpful?
The primary focus I would say is, even if you feel like the school is not giving your child an IEP, I would look back at the IEP and see what services he needs on there. And see if you can build it into an accommodation too. And I always suggest, if you have a student or a child that doesn't have an IEP or 504, always start out with an IEP, because that always provides more protections. But know that you can ask for a 504 if the school does not provide an IEP, or the org says that he does not qualify, or the says that the child does not qualify for an IEP. I've had some, and just be prepared. Like sometimes, like I said, I've had situations where we've gone through an IEP process, an ARC process, gone through an ARC, and said, okay, now I want to do a 504 plan because they said the student doesn't qualify. sometimes some districts try to go, okay, well, you know the process for that. So, be, you know, step back, be prepared, have your letters ready, make sure you have everything documented too. And if you've got any questions, you've got my email address on the PowerPoint and Kentucky's Protection Advocacy's email address. If you call us, we will always call you back within 3 business days with a question. Somebody will call, if you call us, somebody will take information and then it'll be assigned to somebody.
Thank you so much. And what we will make sure that we send that email out that has this, and anywhere that Whitney had where it gave web links within the PDF, you'll be able to click on that to access it. We'll also include the other 2 handouts. If we can help in any way, always reach out to us too. We work very closely with PNA, and yes, they are one of the great partners to help our children and families as we all work together to build those positive relationships. So we are so grateful. And I'll also tell you, the recording for the webinar will be available as soon as we get it closed captioned and put on our YouTube channel. So that will be available. And we'll also follow up with the email if you want to go back and hear something, or if someone couldn't join that you want to share it with, you'll have a link that you could share that, as well as you'll be able to access the handouts too. So thank you so much, Whitney. We greatly appreciate it. And as always, I love working with you, and you help our children and families so much.
Well, I appreciate working with Kentucky Spin, Rhonda, and you, because you're always there for the families.
Well, oh, and we got to thank you, Whitney, also from the question chat box. So you've greatly helped us all. And so you all just stay tuned. We've got a lot more webinars and different videos that we could share. So we'll make sure you can subscribe to our listserv. But we will have this information sent out to you. And I hope you all have a wonderful, safe day, and take care now. Bye-bye.
Bye.